Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Colleen Harding, and I am delighted to welcome you all here with us on this lovely June morning. Wasn't it wonderful to see the sunshine this morning?
Yes.
I almost went out on the river rather than coming to church, but I am here.
We can go.
Well, no, because he has to stay. Today we are wishing a very special happy Father's Day to all the fathers here with us or joining us on YouTube today. If you play a significant role in the life of a young person, we would like to thank you. Best wishes to everyone celebrating a special event this coming week, a special happy birthday to Eileen Thompson and to Laurie Cadoux. And a happy anniversary to Brian and Susan Tunnicliffe. The summer edition of our newsletter, Grace's Chatter, was sent out by email on Friday. If you are on our email list, then check your inbox for your copy. But there are also printed copies available on the table at the back of the church. And pick one up on your way out if you're interested in knowing more about what's going on here at Grace. Please note that the church office will be closed Friday, June the 23rd, and Monday, June the 26th, while Laurie is away. Grace Church has significantly upgraded our sound system here in the sanctuary, and we now have a hearing assistance system which broadcasts via Bluetooth. Welcome to the 21st century. If you have a Bluetooth setting on your hearing aid, you can pair it with the church's PA system. And if you have Bluetooth earbuds or headphones of your own, you can do the same. Speak to Paul Harding if you would like assistance to set this up. And one final announcement. Half Moon Bay is having a fundraising concert with our own Cliff Edwards next Saturday, June the 24th, at 1 p.m. at the Boat Museum. Donations are welcome. So put it on your calendar, folks. Enjoy the service.
Thank you. Dearly beloved, this community of faith celebrates National Indigenous History Month and take seriously the commitments made to First Nations through the National Truth and Reconciliation Commission report. Therefore, we acknowledge the original nations of this land and recognize with respect a rich history filled with spirituality, rich culture, and work together to make this world a better place for all people. Welcome to this safe space where love is our leader and joy is our desire as we journey together. Beloved, as Colleen mentioned, today we celebrate Father's Day. And we celebrate all who are father figures as well to others, so that everything we do it to make a difference in this world. Today, our spiritual focus reminds us that this is God's world, and in spite of all evidence to the contrary, one day it will conform to God's will and to God's way. We light this Christ candle to remember that the smallest light dissipates darkness. Therefore, we are not alone when Christ's light is always with us. Our call to worship is responsive. The bold prints are your part. Beloved, return to the triune holy God who calls you to steadfast love. Just mean it when you read it, please. Okay, let's do that again. Beloved, return to the triune holy God who calls you to steadfast love.
We come willingly.
The Lord desires love, not sacrifice.
We come willingly.
Return to the one who heals and binds, revives and raises up.
We come willingly.
The Lord desires knowledge, not burnt offerings. Beloved, our first song of praise is from Voices United 296. This is God's wondrous world. Let us sing as one family and we'll stand as able.
Beloved, please be seated. Truly, God is the ruler yet. No matter what the situation is around us, what the circumstances are in the world, God is the ruler of this wondrous world that God created. So let us always sing and let the heavens ring. God reigns, let earth be glad. We were just having a short conversation with the choir
And I said, my mother used to say, sing whenever you can, because the devil is afraid of music. So there you go. Sing, because that will put them to shame. Because if our circumstances are terrible, but yet we sing and rejoice, the devil is defeated. That's the bottom line. Beloved, as followers of Jesus, let us read responsively this prayer of acknowledgement, which is written by our neighbors and friends, Kevin John Saylor and Frayne McCarthy. Today, in the United Church of Canada, it is Indigenous Day of Prayer, or Sunday of Prayer. And I do want to send my apologies to Kevin for misspelling his last name. So that just shows you that even your minister is not perfect. So it's all good. So sorry, Kevin, if you're watching this. So anyhow, let us open our hearts and minds as we hear these words and response at the very end. The bold part is yours. We acknowledge that we are gathered here today on the unceded land of the First Peoples of Turtle Island. This we will not forget. We acknowledge that it is by the grace of the First Peoples that we have been able to make our home here, on their land, where we are free to live, work, and gather together in peace. For this, we are thankful. We acknowledge the harm that was done is being done to our Indigenous brothers and sisters by the settler community. We recognize the part that we have played and continue to play, whether actively or passively, unwittingly or deliberately, in this terrible ongoing history. For these trespasses, we are truly sorry. Would you join me? And so, we now pledge to do better, and we humbly commit ourselves to the just pursuit of truth and reconciliation. For Christ's help with this promise to the First Peoples, we pray, amen. Truly, friends, it takes over 5 generations to heal the wounds of the past. So we have a responsibility to do better than our ancestors in this matter. We have the responsibility, as a descendant of an Armenian genocide survivor, I have a responsibility to share my father's story, my parents' story, my grandparents' story, and remind the world that we can do better. Our next hymn is from More Voices, number 135, Called by Earth and Sky. This is our song for the journey. Let us stand as able and sing together.
Thank you.
be seated. Anyone know what's in this little packet? Oh, you must be all great gardeners. Yes, with love from my father-in-law. I said, Dad, do you have any seeds left? He said, yes, but you need to explain to people how to do it. I said, Dad, I'm going to use it as an example for something else. He said, oh, okay, then that's a different conversation. That's your department. How big are seeds? Very small, aren't they? They are so small that if you drop it, you might think it's just a dust thing, right? But after you plant it, what do you do?
Water
it so that it will grow. You don't go in and check and open the soil and say, oh, I'm just checking on you. Do you do that? No, you just let it rest. You did your part, and you continue to do the rest. Today's gospel reading, we will hear that Jesus is calling everyone to plant seeds of love and healing wherever they go. When Jesus sends his disciples out, he gives them guidelines. I know when you hear it, you're going to say, oh my goodness, this is so convoluted. I'm giving you the cheating notes, okay? The end, the bottom line is to plant love, to plant healing, to plant peace. Where do you think you have experienced seeds of love?
Here.
Here. Susan, I'll pay you later. Where else? Family. I mean, today we're celebrating Father's Day. I hate to admit it that there are some abusive individuals, but yet, on the other hand, we know there's a lot of loving fathers, loving father figures as well, right? So we experience love from, but does that love have to be big? Did we pay you, Susan, to come to this church?
No,
like we didn't say we're going to get you a diamond ring or anything. No, we didn't. Now, don't get any ideas. We didn't. But what brought you here? Love. Love. You experienced love from different people and you decided to come here. Think about who has shared seeds of love with you. And it doesn't have to be just Grace United Church. Who has shared seeds of love with you? We have a wedding coming up on Saturday. Woo-hoo! We have a happy first anniversary for Tom and Diane soon. So, where have you experienced love? And even though we have lost loved ones, we all have lost loved ones, but their seeds of love are in us. And that grows. And then when that grows, it overflows that we share that with the world. Think about this today on this Father's Day and thank your heavenly parent, God the Creator, who has planted seeds of love in us through Jesus, through prophets before him, through each other on this day in 21st century. So today Jesus calls us once again to just plant seeds of love. That's it. You don't have to stir the pot. Just plant, water, and God will do the rest. No matter where you are, offer love. Offer love. The other day, I had to do a funeral. After the funeral, I went to No Frills, which is my stop, where I do lots of pastoral care there, by the way. And then all of a sudden, I heard a voice behind me say, Reverend Takumi! I turned around, and it is one of the waitresses that serves me at Musky Jake's all the time. She said, I'm sorry, I'm disturbing you. I said, no, you're not. You can stop me anytime. I said, are you ready for a hug? And she said, yes. I said, okay, here we go. Of course, everybody else in No Frills was looking. Who the heck is this crazy minister? Because I was wearing my clerical shirt, right? So don't be afraid to be the crazy fool for Christ who shows love, love, and love. So friends, let us sing together our song of illumination, Voices United 382, Breathe on Me, Breath of God, and don't forget on your way out, I have some children's activities, even adults can do, for you to take home. All right? Let us sing.
Good morning. We listen for the sacred story. Gospel of Matthew 9:35 to 10:23. Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You received without payment, give without payment. Take no gold or silver or copper in your belts, no bag for your journey, or two tunics or sandals or a staff. For laborers deserve their food. Whatever town or village you enter, find out who in it is worthy, and stay there until you leave. As you enter the house, greet it. If the house is worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it is not worthy, let your peace return to you. If anyone will not welcome you or listen to your words, shake off the dust from your feet as you leave that house or town. Truly I tell you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah on the day of judgment than for that town. See, I am sending you out like sheep into the midst of wolves. So be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Beware of them, for they will hand you over to councils and flog you in the synagogues, and you will be dragged before governors and kings because of me, as a testimony to them and the Gentiles. When they hand you over, do not worry about how you are to speak or what you are to say, for what you are to say will be given to you at that time. For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Brother will betray brother to death, and a father, his child, and children will rise against parents and have them put to death. And you will be hated by all because of my name. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. When they persecute you in one town, flee to the next. For truly I tell you, you will not have gone through all the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. Here ends today's reading. May the Spirit of wisdom and add understanding to these words. Thanks be to God.
Sometimes the load is heavy, and sometimes the road is long, and sometimes, Lord, this heart of mine is not so very strong, but thy will be done. I do not ask you to take this cup from me. I only ask your guidance o'er paths I cannot see. And
Let us pray. Holy Father in heaven, thy will be done here on earth. You need us to be partners with you so that we can change this world with one act of kindness, one seed of love at a time. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts and minds not only be acceptable for your kingdom, but also transform us and transform this world to the better. We pray in the name of the greatest transformer of all time, Jesus himself. Amen. Beloved, I'm not so sure if you are paying attention to our weekly scripture readings from the Gospel of Matthew. There's not going to be a quiz, don't worry about it. But I invite you to think if you have heard or listened on YouTube last week's and today. The bottom line of both readings, the Matthew readings that we are doing, is about how to be a disciple of Jesus. If you are here and you are there on YouTube watching us, or you are at any other church, you are a disciple of Jesus. If you call yourself Christian, you are a disciple of Jesus. Christian means follower of Christ. And here, Jesus gives the disciples guidelines on how to plant the seeds of hope and love and healing wherever they are. Reverend Dr. David Loss reminds us that the authors of the Gospels were not like court stenographers, taking down every single word that Jesus said, or our session clerk or official board secretary who works so hard to make sure they write down exactly what's being discussed and what the decision is, because we want to make sure that we know word by word. But all four Gospels do not contain the exact same words. Therefore, each one speaks from a different witness. In Matthew's gospel, it is familiar, the audience is familiar with the Old Testament and the law of Moses. So Matthew is speaking to the Jews of his time. The gospel of Mark is almost like a Twitter post. It's the shortest gospel of them all, and anyone, if you attempt, I haven't attempted, you can learn the entire gospel of Mark by memorizing it, because it's that short compared to others. But originally, even though in the Bible Matthew is the first, originally the gospel of Mark was the very first gospel written. That's the evidence we have. So Mark wrote down this gospel so fast and so short to the point because he knew it was so important for the world to know and let it go viral in 21st century word, to go viral for people to know about Jesus. And Luke is addressing his gospel to the Gentiles. And Jesus does more healing in Luke than anywhere else. So for Luke, whose profession was a doctor, speaks more of Jesus' healing than any other gospel. Do you get my sense where I'm getting at? Right? Aren't those interesting little fun facts? And of course, for the Gospel of John, John is so special. John affirms and reaffirms over and over again that Jesus is the way, Jesus is the truth, Jesus is the gate, Jesus is the way to the abundant life. Jesus is the I am. Jesus is the Good Shepherd. So that is John. In reality, all these Gospels, they were working from raw materials of eyewitness accounts and how they experienced this man called Jesus. And we all know, if there is an event somewhere and you ask 10 different people who witnessed that event, you will get 15 different reports, right? Because everyone reinterprets things on their own way. But they all have the same focus. They are all talking about the same person or the same event. And the focus of the Gospels was Jesus was and what his life and death and resurrection meant to those who followed him, who were in his presence, and to this day what that means for us. It's as simple as that. Beloved, following Jesus is simple. It is humanity that makes it complicated. You've heard me say this before. When people ask me, Reverend Taku, what's the difference between, the Catholic Church, the United Church, this? I say, you know what? Sometimes it is just where to put the comma in that creed. That's what has separated churches from one to a gazillion different churches. That's what it is. And today's reading, Matthew offers two important glimpses of the person and the mission of Jesus. First, glimpse that we get about Jesus is healing all those who come to him, no matter what their ailment or their life situation is. In his healing everyone, even us, we don't only learn about his power of love and God's glory, but we also learn about the characteristics of a discipleship. And what is one of the important characteristics of discipleship? Recognizing the needs of others, putting others' needs before yours, and responding to those needs. A simple example. Sometimes at dinner time, I realize my father-in-law is looking around. I say, Dad, what are you looking for? Oh, he says, you realized I was looking around? I say, yeah. He says, oh, just the salt. Okay. You pay attention. We pay attention. Let me repeat that. Disciples of Jesus recognize the needs of others and respond to those needs. Jesus responded to all the needs of those around him, and he was crucified. I didn't say it's easy to be a disciple of Jesus. Why was he crucified? Because religious leaders did not like Jesus disturbing the status quo. So they had him crucified. But we all know, beloved, as resurrection people, we all know that death did not have the last word, but love did. It is very important to remember that Jesus did not respond to all the various needs of the people because he wanted them to become disciples. He responded to people's needs because he knew they had deep needs that the world ignored. Just like the church today, we are to help others without any expectations. We are to plant seeds of love to help others in their difficult times as much as we are able. This is why we are partners with the food bank. This is why we are partners with Gananoque Food Network to teach people how to cook with a budget and how to prepare things healthy. This is why we do fundraising with the pies. This is why we have a benevolent fund that reaches beyond the walls of this church building. This is why we offer scholarship to students. Maybe they're not big, but they are small seeds that God will sanctify and multiply them. I'm going to have the honor next Tuesday, the 27th, to be at Gananoque Secondary School and present the scholarship from this church to two students there. This is why the church opens up once a month its doors for the Pride kids to come and have a safe space to gather. Beloved, this is all discipleship. Either you realize it or not, you are all disciples. You are. And we have fun at the same time, don't we, Susan?
We do.
Beloved, Jesus comes to all those who came, who were harassed by the government and helpless, physically, mentally, financially, emotionally. And Jesus, most of the time, said to them, do not tell anyone that you are healed, that you have an abundant life. Just, you know, but the crowds still followed him because the crowds realize how the ones that came to him ill are returning home healed and happy. You can tell. You can tell how your life is changed. And he heals them freely because he has compassion for them. Beloved, the word compassion comes from the root Latin of come with, and passion is pain. So to be accompanying someone who is in difficult time, passion has nothing to do with romance, people. It has just evolved throughout history. But this passion is about pain and suffering. You've heard the expression, passion of Christ, right? So it's the suffering of Christ. Beloved, last week we heard how Matthew was called to discipleship, and he was a tax collector. He was one of the ones who harassed helpless people. And now in this chapter, he writes how the leaders of that time failed the people. Jesus saw the people around him like sheep without a shepherd. And he just does not make that imagery up. Matthew does not make this up. But he draws from the long tradition of describing Israel's leaders as shepherds. Remember, Matthew's work is written, it's drawn from ancient Israel. And his audience understands these imageries that he uses. All of Israel's leaders were supposed to be like the good and faithful shepherds to tend the needs of their flock. Somebody needs to go to all the parliaments of the world, starting in Canada, and tell all the government on every level that they should and must attend to the needs of the people. You know, in French, they say placoter, right? Which means just talking. Yap, yap. We need to tell our government, wake up and smell the coffee and take care of your people. Don't point fingers, he did this, he did that, he did that. I'm all for accountability. But do not waste your time and money and energy just to glorify your own self by pointing fingers to others. Forgetting that their own work is to take care of the people who they represent. The people who voted for them. So the church, beloved, like Jesus, is to show compassion and care for the helpless and the harassed people like sheep without a shepherd. This is why Jesus implores his disciples, you and me included, to ask the Lord of the harvest for more laborers, because there is simply so much need in the world. And the more people helping by offering compassion, care, and understanding, the world will get better, I promise you. And you know what's the fun part about becoming a disciple of Jesus full time? I don't mean you quit your job or anything, but with your heart committing yourself to the work of Jesus, you don't even have to buy a starter kit. Everything is free. It's not like Tupperware, Party Light, Mary Kay, Pampered Chef, or any other company that you must buy a starter kit. Your starter kit is to accept God's love and share that love with others. Our new job, our job is to be eager and prepared to love unconditionally. This is why the church seeks more volunteers and financial help. Not because the church is going on vacation altogether with that money, but simply to make a difference in this world and reach out to the margins of life. Beloved, how often have you felt under pressure? You've come to the right place. How often have you felt helpless? You've come to the right place. How often have you felt lonely and sad? You've come to the right place. Just make sure to go and to speak with someone that you've never spoken before. And extend a bridge of a respectful relationship. We are all the body of Christ. We are not just members of this immediate church, but all those who are in the margins of life, forgotten and stranded. They are our brothers and sisters. And those of us who know the joy of the Lord, we are ready and prepared and eager, and we ask the Lord to strengthen us so that we can be laborers of love and love alone, to work with the shepherd, to gather in the harvest of broken people and distraught souls by offering love and love and love and love alone. Where are you today, beloved? Are you feeling harassed and helpless, or prepared and eager to serve the Almighty? No matter what situation you are in,
Jesus, the good shepherd, the Lord of the harvest, sees you and is ready to help you and is ready to teach you if you open your heart and say, "Teach me, Lord." Our spiritual focus was a great reminder today that this is God's world. And in spite of all evidence to the contrary, one day it will conform to God's will and to God's way. And I will humbly add to this thought and say, but God needs your partnership. God needs my partnership. God needs our partnership. Do we ignore the call or respond to it with joy? Would you come? Would you come and let all your pains at the foot of the cross? And afterwards, as resurrection people, as healed individuals, I don't mean physically, I mean emotionally and mentally and spiritually, healed and filled with hope, we can go forward and give our best to others, which is indirectly giving our best to God. May it be so. May you be healed. May you be strengthened. May you know and remember always you are beloved and your job is to love others. Amen. Would you please remain seated and let us sing together, "Lord, listen to your children praying," and we will sing it twice. Would you please join me for a short prayer of hope and healing? Afterwards, you'll join me for the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Holy Creator, Mother and Father to all, you give us all the power of love to make this world a better place. Therefore, this morning we come to you boldly and seek that power of love once again to enlighten us, to strengthen us, and help us to become bold disciples and humble followers who accept and live through your grace. This morning, in the silence of our hearts, we lift up our own families. We continue to add our church family in the silence of our hearts. We lift up our town, our province, our country, the globe, the entire globe. We pray for all those who are stuck in war-torn parts of the world. We lift up places like Dauphin, Manitoba, where shattered, beautiful journey has been shattered into death and pain and suffering. We pray for your healing presence to be evident. We pray for all who are in hospitals, those who have been released from hospitals, but they're still in pain. May your healing presence be evident to them. May we be the sign that leads to your love, O God. May your love be manifested wherever we are. And now we pray together the prayer of Jesus that is printed and it's paraphrased, and we pray as one family. Eternal Spirit, Earth Maker, Pain Bearer, Life Giver, Source of all that is and shall be, Father and Mother of us all, loving God in whom is heaven, the hallowing of your name echo through the universe. The way of your justice be followed by peoples of the world. Your heavenly will be done by all created beings. Your commonwealth of peace and freedom sustain our hope and come on earth. With the bread we need for today, feed us. In the hurts we absorb from one another, forgive us. In times of temptation and test, strengthen us. From trials too great to endure, spare us. From the grip of all that is evil, free us. For you reign in the glory of the power that is love, now and forever. Amen.
Your generosity matters. The path toward healing, Murray Pruden's work. I think that we still have so much to give, to teach, and to be in relationship with. Healing begins with truth and reconciliation. In late October 2022, the federal government recognized the residential school system as an act of genocide against Canada's Indigenous peoples. It was a reminder that we are still very much on the path to reconciliation and healing. We know that we have an impact, as the United Church of Canada, says the Reverend Murray Pruden. He is Nahaya Cree First Nations, from the Goodfish Lake and Saddle Lake First Nations, and is the current Executive Minister for Indigenous Ministries and Justice for the United Church of Canada. Supported by mission and service, Pruden has made significant gains in building relationships of trust and healing between the church and the Indigenous communities. After unmarked graves were discovered in Kamloops, BC, in 2021, the United Church gave an additional $3 million to help Indigenous communities respond, mourn, heal, and potentially find other unmarked graves. Because we believe every child matters, the funds also supported the dedication of memorials to lost children, like the one for a BC community that raised a totem pole funded in part by mission and service. Other healing initiatives include the translation of the Mohawk Language Bible, the Food for the North program, healing circles, and programs for Indigenous youth to learn and reclaim their languages. Pruden stresses the need for patience. Ever since Kamloops, we had many non-Indigenous church communities and people ask, what they can do or how they can really contribute in different ways, he says. And we at the time really kind of put our hands up and said, whoa, we need to pause for a minute because we need to mourn. I think that we still have so much to give, to teach, and to be in relationship with. And as long as we have a greater understanding within the church and the supports, we can do it. Relationships, friendships, understanding, and trust. These are the foundations of the work Mission and Service is doing across Turtle Island, thanks to your generosity.
Beloved, truly, there is so much to be done in the world, and there are many ways we can all partner up with God's mission through Grace United Church and help make a difference. If you are encouraged and nourished through this community of faith, would you consider to give as able? We never ask for a minimum or a maximum. We only ask, like God asks, your best, whatever you can share for the mission of God. The offertory plates are all over the sanctuary, and those online, please go to our website and find the different ways that you can partner up with us. Not being here with us doesn't mean anything. You are still part of this family. So join us in partnership. Let us sing together, "What Can I Do?" And let's sing it 3 times. Holy God, who gives life, nourishment, and strength to all creation, we thank you for the community of faith you have built, for your servants who have held fast to you through centuries, for the teachings and the witness of our ancestors, for the gospel's welcome to all in need, for the healing that comes from your watchfulness. Bless these gifts that all may be nurtured in truth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Beloved, giving money to the work of God is not enough. We need to live in such a way that God can continue to plant seeds of love no matter where we are. So our last hymn is a song of commitment. Let us stand as able and sing together, "I'm gonna live so God can use me." And please sing it like you mean it.
Thank you.
awesome. Awesome. Thank God for God's gift of joy and strength. Now, truthfully, don't you feel better now than the moment you entered here this morning?
Yes.
Yes, I do too. I really, really do. Beloved, next Sunday, only next Sunday, I will be away in Toronto area where I will meet with another marrying couple preparing for their partnership journey. And it is only Sunday, so I am working during this week. And Tammy will be here alongside with Paul Harding and the choir to celebrate Canada Day with you. So please come and bring friends. Hear God's word through another voice. Because God speaks in different ways, with different voices, even different animals, if you didn't know about it. Please pray for me as I journey on, and I will pray for you, I promise you. And now, beloved, no matter how harassed and helpless you might feel sometimes, go out prepared with God's love and eager by the power of this love, and help the kingdom of God be evident to all. Remember, life is short. We do not have much time to gladden the hearts of those who journey the way with us. So be swift to love and make haste to be kind to all who come your way. So go in peace and live love. Amen.